When looking back at the 2000s, it's almost unbelievable to think that so many critically acclaimed titles showed up in a relatively short amount of time. For me personally, it was the first time I came into contact with franchises like Call of Duty, Medal of Honor, and Grand Theft Auto, just to name a few. Most of my excitement, however, came from cars and car culture. After reaching an age where I was finally old enough to play something other than LEGO Racers, Walt Disney World Quest Magical Racing Tour, and Mario Kart DS, fucking love all of these though. My first contact with a more mature racing game was with a franchise that would remain my absolute favorite for the upcoming decade. This same franchise, which had already been around for years at that point, had just seen its transition towards the at that point hugely popular import tuner scene, a trend that would remain within this franchise and this genre for years to come. Of course, it's Need for Speed I'm talking about. Even though this franchise, which now consists of 25 games over the course of the past 30 years, is still right up there as one of the best-selling franchises ever, in conversation, people tend to steer away from the humble beginnings this franchise had with games like Hot Pursuit and Porsche Unleashed, or the more recent and more divisive games like Payback, Heat, and most recently, Unbound. No, most people will pretty quickly delve straight into what is now deemed the golden age of the franchise, also known as the Black Box era. With the fanbase completely divided as to whether or not the games outside of this so-called golden age are any good at all, these 9 years and 9 main series Need for Speed games that developer EA Black Box made also raise a lot of discussions in and of itself. And the game I'm going to talk about is, in my opinion, one of the most interesting cases, Need for Speed Underground 2. Right after the hugely successful game that made the first step into the import tuner scene, but right before the critically acclaimed classic that, according to many, perfected this genre and is still seen as the best game in the franchise. The result is a game that did just enough to garner the title of full-on sequel, but didn't do enough to get the critical acclaim its successor would eventually get. However, this game, that is about to celebrate its 20th birthday, is without a doubt also worth a replay. And so I did. But did that actually sour my nostalgic view on this incredibly enjoyable arcade racer? Or is it actually an underappreciated gem that secretly deserves the same cult status as that one game that always gets all of the credit? Let's find out in this sort of review on Need for Speed Underground 2. As is the case with most franchises nowadays, it's not just one developer that is responsible for all of the Need for Speed games. During the development of 2002's Need for Speed Hot Pursuit 2, development was split up, with EA Seattle working on the Xbox, GameCube, and Windows version of the game, while Black Box worked on a more advanced version for the more powerful PlayStation 2. During development, EA acquired Black Box, now known under the incredibly creative name EA Black Box. And not long after that, development started on a new Need for Speed game. Every game in the series up until that point mainly focused around exotic cars driving through exotic landscapes at high speeds, but this development team must have had a craving for something new and innovative. Around the late 90s and early 2000s, the cultural landscape would shift from these earlier mentioned exotic cars towards more affordable cars kitted out with excessive body kits, vibrant paint jobs, and the necessary engine upgrade here and there. The immense popularity of what came to be known as the import tuner scene could be attributed to several things, like the Fast and Furious movies, the growing amount of street racing meetups worldwide, or maybe because Japanese car manufacturers decided to release banger after banger after banger, while most American cars looked like the thing your grandparents would drive, while Europeans decided that this was a good idea. Long story short, Vin Diesel was now the coolest man on the planet, everyone wanted this instead of this, and Black Box now knew the road they had to take for their next game, which would eventually become 2003's Need for Speed Underground. Trading in the scenic roads of France and Germany for the messy, poorly lit nighttime streets of Olympic City. The first game in the franchise to take place in just one city and actually feature a story, or at least something resembling that, and the most extensive car customization seen up until that point. though I'm willing to bet that those things aren't even the most memorable aspects of the game, since Underground made sure that everyone started feeling nostalgic over Lil Jon singing about his sweaty balls, and rubber banding that still gives many a poor soul nightmares. Little did Black Box know at that point that they would become one of the forerunners of the cultural wave they decided to follow. It would be an instant success after release, and even for a time be the best-selling Need for Speed game ever. Despite its success, many people will tell you the game definitely wasn't without its flaws. Where people grew attached to the high-speed police chases in Black Box's previous game, Olympic City seemed to be lacking a police department in its entirety. Let alone that the city itself was fully modeled for a more open-ended approach to set police chases. But despite the term open world becoming common knowledge this year, due to another pretty well-known franchise, no free roam mode has ever been put into the game officially. Needless to say, it was a solid foundation to build upon, and work on a sequel started quickly afterwards. A sequel that would become known simply as Underground 2. Welcome to Bayview, a city forever trapped in a 4x3 resolution if it were not for the franchise's amazing modding community. Bayview characterizes itself by having large illuminated billboards, expensive houses, and huge skyscrapers on the one hand, and long stretches of highway, dingy dockyards, and dangerous canyon passes on the other. It's here where our nameless protagonist arrives on Bayview International Airport, 6 months after being involved in an accident caused by an unknown gang, only recognizable by a scythe tattoo. It's a direct follow-up to the story of Underground, in which the protagonist is crowned as the best driver of Olympic City after defeating its main rival Eddie, with the help of his friend Samantha. With his skyline completely totaled, Samantha helps out by lending him her friend Rachel's 350Z. The first minutes of gameplay are made up of driving towards a car lot to buy her own car, but the player can also choose to enjoy Rachel's car just a little longer. In a fun attention to detail, the other characters in the game will respond accordingly, and especially Rachel won't be very happy.
Hey man, I want my car back. You better haul over here ASAP or I'm putting the word out on you. And that means no more racing till I say so. Get over here, now!
After buying your first car, you are now free to drive through Bayview and participate in any event you like. Sort of. You see, Bayview is split up into several different districts, which you'll unlock more of as you progress through the story. Starting off with the biggest one, City Core, you'll then move on to Beacon Hill, Jackson Heights, and eventually Cole Harbor, which for some reason has been split up into East and West that have to be unlocked separately. City Core is your typical city center with large skyscrapers, hotels, and casinos. The entire core is surrounded by a large network of roads known as Highway 27. From large residential areas in El Norte to the fabulous nightlife of South Market, there's more than enough to see in this district. Apart from all the splendor though, there's also a wide variety of underpasses and sketchy alleyways in order to hammer home the underground racing aspect of the game. You'll soon move up to Beacon Hill. On the one hand, pretty similar in scope to the city core, with lots of shops and hotels, as well as a harbor where a huge cruise ship resides. Though Beacon Hill is much more of a residential area, with more neighborhoods and alleyways, as well as its own nature park where you can visit a greenhouse. Even further up north, there's Jackson Heights. With its twisty roads and constant height differences, it is arguably the most challenging to race through. You'll see things like a broadcasting tower, an observatory, and many mansions here, as well as having the best view of the entire city. The last two areas you'll unlock form Cole Harbor, the industrial heart of the city. Many narrow roads connect the harbor to storage facilities, a rail yard, and even a steel mill. All in all, this is by far the most bleak district of all of them. You've probably seen it already, but there's a nice amount of variety in this city. From the twists and turns up north to the busy streets and bright lights downtown and the narrow industrial alleyways in the south, it suits different sorts of driving styles, as well as variety in environments. It's a pretty impressive feat when you take into account that many newer titles fail to have cities that are as closely packed with buildings, as well as having as much variety. When I reviewed a bunch of the newer Need for Speed games a few years ago, one of the things that stood out to me was the fact that I sound like this throughout the entire video. Hey guys, Matt here, and in the last few weeks I tried to relive my childhood. But also that, apart from Payback, there was a notable lack of variety in environments in those games. Sure, the cities in those games look more realistic, but that mostly means that it just lacks creativity and interesting landmarks. And honestly, if I want to see a realistic city, I just go outside. And most of the time that just makes me grumpy. Underground 2 is an arcade racer. If the racing isn't meant to be realistic, then why should the city be? Give me laughably unrealistic infrastructure. Give me a shortcut through a greenhouse. Give me a fight over first place through a steel mill. In this aspect, even Black Box's own flagship title falls victim. Most Wanted Spalman City has a similar sort of creativity in its map layout, but the infamous 6th and 7th generation color filters also make this game fall victim to every district looking very similar in its tone. The same argument can be made against Underground 2 since the entire game takes place at night, but because of its use of vibrant colors and a notable lack of a filter, there is never a moment in which I thought that any of it looked bland, in huge contrast to something like Need for Speed Heat. In many ways, Bayview itself is the main character in Underground 2. Not just because of the way it looks, but also because of how it plays. I'm going to go more into detail on the gameplay aspect of the city later on in the video, but of course the developers want to make a beautifully stylistic city in the game where they introduced free roam for the first time in the series. Give people some incentive to just aimlessly drive around and especially look around. Not to say that it doesn't have its flaws, because of course a game from 2004 doesn't have the same graphical fidelity as a modern day racing game. The entire world basically consists of 2D textures and a bunch of low-res pictures slapped onto 3D models. That also becomes more obvious when you look at character models, lighting, draw distance, and the excessive amount of popping you'll encounter throughout the city. Newer games can easily be seen as more open because of the amount of destructibility and accessibility that this game is notably lacking. It's things like that you might want to take into consideration when booting up this game, but honestly, does it really matter that much? When driving through these streets at an eye-watering pace, many of the structures you'll pass will be reduced to mere blurry outlines, and as soon as that happens, you won't even notice the game's graphical limitations. What will be noticeable is the amount of times the game will crash out of nowhere. Even though I'm not really sure what causes the game to just quit by itself, as far as I could find anything about this subject on the internet, the improved frame rate of contemporary hardware really messes up the game's physics and overall coding. Long story short, it confuses the NPCs into making absurd moves, flying into the air out of nowhere, and even mess up gameplay in some frustrating ways I'll explain later on. But most of all, it means that the game regularly decides that it doesn't want to be played anymore. But the whole subject of graphical limitations actually got me thinking. With the slew of amazing titles I've played over the past few years, I realized that there are so many games nowadays that intentionally go for a more old-school look. Just from the videos I've made last year, you can already see this ongoing trend in the form of the System Shock remake, Warhammer 40k Boltgun, and even something like the 8-bit stages in Mario Odyssey. As long as gameplay doesn't feel outdated and it still looks good stylistically, a AAA title from years ago now just looks and feels like an entirely new game with a very particular art style, which is one of two reasons why this game might be even more fun to play nowadays, with the other being... Explaining the world of Underground 2 goes much further than just talking about Bayview. This game is set in the year it is released, which means that now, 20 years after its release, stepping out of that airplane feels like stepping into a time machine. From the moment you'll push the throttle of that 350Z, you receive your first SMS, and you hear Skindred or Rise Against blast through your speakers, it becomes abundantly clear that 2004 isn't the present day anymore. Internet wasn't nearly as big as it is today, MTV still actually showed music, and as I've said before, heavily customized cars became a huge part of pop culture. Not just because of the over-the-top car transformations of Pimp My Ride, the insane vehicles you'd see in video clips, or the aforementioned Fast and Furious movies, but also because of Underground 2 itself. Video games were now basically on the forefront of this cultural stream, an incredibly cool aspect of the game that can only now be appreciated. You cannot underestimate how important the soundtrack is in creating that sort of immersion. I still get goosebumps from the very moment I open the game and hear that tacky Snoop Dogg version of Riders on the Storm, and there's a reason why Spider-Bait's rendition of Black Betty remained a meme within the Need for Speed community to this day. Or, you know, at least in Kuro's videos 3 years ago, but still. Personally, this was the game that introduced me to artists like Queens of the Stone Age and Felix the House Cat, and those can still be found in my playlist now. Even the part of the soundtrack that is specifically composed for this game by Tom Salta fits the game's setting remarkably well. A nice mix between heavy guitars, floaty electronics, and fucking Exhibit really brings all of this together. While the graphical limitations don't bother me within the game world, it becomes more apparent in the game's menus, heads-up display, and most of all, its cutscenes. Full in-engine cutscenes were far from the norm in 2004, and unfortunately the green screen galore wouldn't start for another year. And so the developers had to get creative. The comic book style panels they opted to go for don't bother me. In fact, I think it fits the overall aesthetic of the game, and I will never get enough of that ridiculous mid-2000s over-the-top jank. However, the fact that they're displayed in a resolution that gives Minecraft dirt blocks a run for their money does bother me. Widescreen fix or not, this is what makes the game feel dated. On top of that, the dull grays that are being used in the menus as well as the HUD aren't garnering it any praise either, but at least those are far less interruptive. And yet again, none of it is bad enough to distract from the actual main attraction. Rachel is the person who pulls most of the strings in Bayview. She's the one who helps you get your garage and gets you acquainted with the underground racing scene. Within this scene, you'll butt heads with the earlier mentioned side tattoo wearing gang known as the Wraths and their leader Caleb, who desperately wants you to become part of his friend group. You politely decline, however, and go on your way to utilize your brand new free roaming ability, sponsored by a bunch of insurance money that just bought you your own car. Choosing your car might be the hardest choice in any racing game. In Underground 2, this choice might be a bit easier, since the fairly limited choice of 31 cars, of which 4 are regional, meaning you'll only get 2 of these 4 cars depending on what version you're playing, is a far stretch from what you usually see in a racing game. Need for Speed's focus on exotics in the early days is a trend that has been embraced again in many new titles. In fact, if you're not playing a game where switching cars after every race is basically the main focus, the normal daily drivers have all but completely been phased out by modern day's needlessly oversaturated hypercar market. The first Underground game started this trend of sticking with very common cars, and so the range of what you'll encounter will stay fairly similar. Because of that, it's very likely you'll end the game with the same car you'll started in. The only reason you'll see me drive different cars in this review is because of the different handling models I wanted to test, but I also had a playthrough where I only used this 106 from beginning to end. Many things can be said both for and against this choice. It is very satisfying to choose a car and being able to beef it up until the point where it can compete against the best of the bunch, but I can easily understand why people might think it would have been more rewarding to eventually also unlock sports cars. It's a double-edged sword, I get that, but if you see how many fan-favorite cars are in this game, let alone that many people were introduced to these cars through this game, I think the lack of sports cars can be forgiven. For me, it actually even felt refreshing to drive just an ordinary Golf 4 instead of yet another car that looks like the mouth of Sauron. Worth noting is the inclusion of the Cadillac Escalade, Hummer H2, and Lincoln Navigator. They are big and bulky, turn through corners with the subtlety of an aircraft carrier, and are probably only in the game because these are the most 2004 cars anyone could think of. But hey, it's a fun inclusion, and they do have some sort of usefulness eventually. Each car handles just a bit different, but in broad terms they are separated into front wheel, rear wheel, and four wheel drive vehicles. The differences between the three are notable, but not that significant. In my opinion, you can never go wrong with a front-wheel driven shitbox, but rear-wheel drive cars have the benefit of being a bit faster in general, as well as being able to drift easier, and four-wheel drive cars have a bit more grip overall. When driving in these cars, you'll notice an extremely different sort of arcade racing that pretty much defied the black box era of Need for Speed games. Many arcade racers nowadays tend to go for a more slidey experience in order to emphasize the arcade element. Very fast and long corners taken with ridiculously long and perfect drifts at a moment's notice. That sort of handling cannot be found in Underground 2. In fact, these games are characterized by the insane amounts of grip you'll experience. Never will you be able to pull off a split-second maneuver that defies the laws of physics in a game like 2010's Hot Pursuit, but in this game, that is exactly what can make the races so incredibly exciting. Sure, you just shat your pants, but God, did you look cool doing it! On top of this handling model, you can tune your car exactly to your own liking in what many have deemed one of the best and most elaborate tuning systems in arcade racing. Quite surprising for a game that is obviously not a simulator, but in all honesty, I rarely use these sorts of tuning mechanics, and the game can easily still be completed without it. The thing that does influence your car in a notable way is, of course, visually, the cars look about as good as you'd expect from a 2004 game. Of course, it can't compete with the lifelike models we see nowadays, but any car you'll see in this game is still easily recognizable. This is still a Lancer, this is still an Eclipse, and this is still an Atrocity. The cars you can choose from are notably more detailed than any other thing in the game, just compare it to these Java game looking bastards. But that yet again goes back to what I said about this game having style over fidelity. These cars are supposed to be front and center, and nowhere does that become more obvious than in its customization. Within the not so busy streets of Bayview, you can now drive your brand new ride towards your own garage, some of the many events we'll talk about later, but you can also discover several shops. Divided into four different categories, car lot not included, they each represent a specific part of the car you can customize there. The performance shop is the most obvious one. This is where you can upgrade your car's engine. Interestingly, many of the different parts of the car's engine, like intake, exhaust, tires, and turbo, can all be enhanced separately in Underground 2, in comparison to many of its successors that went for a more streamlined, or in Payback's case, more fucking awful system. There's also the opportunity to choose between different manufacturers for these parts, but they don't have any benefit over each other. In a nice attention to detail, your car will look and behave different the further you'll go through the upgrading process. Upgrading the suspension means your car will actually get lowered. Adding a turbo will give you an additional speedometer, and upgrading the engine will change your car's sound significantly. Worth noting is that Nitro in this game works a bit different than normal. Instead of being separate short bursts or one bar that refills over time, in this game you'll have to refill that Nitro's tank by pulling off maneuvers like avoiding traffic, drafting, and power sliding. The body shop is all about the car's exterior. Spoilers, bumpers, headlights, etc. can all be changed around, as well as eventually being turned into carbon fiber. The graphics shop is used for the car's visuals. You can change stickers and paint jobs, as well as being hit by the realization that tires are not actually attached to the cars themselves, because this is 2004 and tires worked differently back then. Lastly, there's the specialty shop. This is where your car goes from a simple family car to Probably the reason why people remember Underground 2's customization as fondly as they do is because of this place. From trunks full of speakers and LCD screens to neon in the engine bay and hydraulics that defy the laws of physics. It's insane, but you've got to appreciate it at the very least, right? Though many people would rather eat their own shoes than giving their Miata the ability to do bunny hops, this has got to be the most insane customization you're able to do in a video game, and that is commendable. Yet still, people are not necessarily stoked about all of it. That's because this game works with a ranking system. Each car you customize can reach a visual rating of 10 stars. At first, this seems to be a positive thing, but in order to reach those 10 stars, you need to keep upgrading your car. Meaning that if you, for example, like your car in a certain way, but it only scores 2 stars, tough luck. You need higher level parts in order to reach those eventual 10 stars. But is it really necessary to reach the highest visual ranking? Unfortunately, yes, and that's because of one very annoying detail. So you've got yourself a car, you've upgraded the engine here and there, maybe you've even put a spoiler on it already. That's not gonna get you to the end credits. Though you can scour the city for all of its money and info icons, you'll have to do something a bit more profitable. Back you go to your world map and you'll see a bunch of events and these little orange Doritos on it. More on those later, let's focus on the former for now. Any place you decide you want to drive to can be set on your GPS system. Not that it works great or something, I mean actual real-life GPS systems didn't even work great back in 2004, but you're gonna need it because this game does not have fast travel. Seen by many as one of the most frustrating aspects of the game, you have to drive to every location and event yourself without being able to skip the route over there. I can understand this resentment up to a certain point, but of course the developers are not going to put a fast travel feature in a game where they just tirelessly designed everything around free roaming for the first time. Many people see this as an outdated gaming trope to artificially lengthen the game, but I just kind of feel bad for the people that just put all this work into Bayview City streets in order to improve one of the key things that the first Underground was missing, only to then hear, "Yeah, no, I want to skip all of that." It's not like Bayview is the size of GTA V's Los Santos, and most of the time shops and events are positioned pretty close to each other, so I'd just start all the way down the map and just work my way up. The developers probably didn't see this as that much of a hassle, and honestly, neither do I. Anyway, back to the story, and now that you have a car, it's time to indulge yourself in the world of illegal street racing. Which means you'll now have to defeat several other drivers, including Wrath members, through different events. There's a decent amount of variety in races to be found in Bayview. The most obvious inclusions are circuit and sprint races. What would any racing game be without them, right? Pretty straight to the point and actually decently laid out through the city streets, especially when the tracks aren't too long. It is important to know that the infamous black box era rubber banding is here in all of its disgusting glory. Either you stay in a very insignificant lead for the entire race and keep everyone behind you at exactly that distance, or your opponents will be unrealistically blasted towards the finish line when you make even the slightest mistake. When driving your SUV through Bayview, a new sort of sprint and circuit race will pop up on your world map, simply known as SUV races. That's basically it. They're sprint and circuit races, but in an SUV. They're not mandatory, just like buying the SUVs themselves, and honestly, the handling model of these things make them way too annoying to be enjoyable. There are also drift and drag events, pretty self-explanatory, but what makes these events unique is their entirely different handling system. When engaging in drift events, your car is much more slippery than normal, making it possible to finally live the initial D life you've always dreamt of. These events are done in indoor circuits, for lack of a better term, but eventually you'll be allowed to do drift events on the curvy roads of Jackson Heights as well. If there is one thing to complain about, it's that these drift events are never really that exciting, simply because they are laughably easy. Drag, however, lives up to its name. It is, in my opinion, the least enjoyable racing event. In order to put all of your focus on the gear shifting, your car steers automatically. Or so the game says, but what they actually mean is that your car just sticks to one lane and with a lot of conviction, you're able to switch lanes. That comes in quite handy since the tracks are always filled with a variety of obstacles. This whole system has never really worked that well, neither in this game nor its predecessor or its successor. Let alone that drag races are the biggest victim of the earlier mentioned hardware difficulties. Because the game isn't able to handle such a high frame rate, when that gear shift indicator flashes green, you're actually already too late. But don't be deterred just by this. Even back in the day, these races sucked, and especially in the beginning hours of the game, you can easily get softlocked behind the very first drag race. Simply because your car can't be made faster than your god-awful rubber banding opponents. Then there are street cross races. Oh no, I mean street X races, because it's 2004 and everything with an X in it is super cool. Honestly, not that much to say about them. They're just very small circuit races, though they might actually be my favorite races in the game. They can be quite challenging, they don't drag on for too long, and when you finally get a nice flow through the corners of these tight circuits, the driving physics really come into its own. Then remember those Doritos on the minimap? Those are actually NPCs you can challenge to a duel known as outrun events. Only able to trigger by driving behind your opponent in free roam, you'll have to overtake him or her and create a distance of 1,000 meters between the two of you in order to win. The one in front decides where you two are going, so the track you can take is basically the entire map. Yet again, in addition to the free roam mechanics, this event can quite frustratingly only go in one of two ways. Or you try to win fair and square, which means you'll be battling against the absolutely dreadful rubber banding, which can't be outrun, and so you drive circles through the map for 2 hours until you give up and quit the game. Or you can spin your opponent out at the exact moment you engage in the event and win within 7 seconds. There's no in between, it's fucking stupid, and there's no fun involved, but it's also not mandatory in order to progress the story, so whatever. If you do decide to cheese your way through these events, you will get cash and early access to some unique upgrades, so there's that. A few events aren't shown to you directly. Some of these can only be found by listening to the messages on your phone.
Yo man, what's up, money? Yo, you got any details on rumors of racing around the airport?
But others have to be unlocked. The latter, known as the Underground Racing League, are races that take place on closed-off tracks and are presented as the more legal aspect of the game. Not only are these the races that unlock new cars and new parts of Bayview, they also take place outside of the city. These leagues can take several stages. At the start of the game, you'll be doing just one race, but near the end, this can be as much as three. The amount of points you scored in that league decides at what position you'll finish. Admittedly, being able to drive on a racetrack is not that interesting, but it's a nice variety in between normal races. Racing on the airfield with airplanes flying over is, however, a lot cooler. It's within these events that you'll attract the attention of several sponsors, of which you can then choose one. This gives you some extra races of your own choice, as well as a big bonus payout. Then finally, every now and then, a star will pop up on your world map. These are special events. They have everything to do with the earlier mentioned visual rating system. Throughout the story, you'll get phone calls for magazine and DVD cover opportunities. With the catch, of course, being that your car needs to have a high enough visual rating. In its core, these are fun to do. Drive to a certain location within the time limit and get the opportunity to take a picture of your car, as well as seeing your car on the cover of a magazine with women in skirts so incredibly short I almost get a bladder infection just by looking at it. But I guess you can see it coming already. The further you'll progress through the game, the higher your star rating has to be, and so upgrading your car basically becomes mandatory. Even though I personally never had a problem with this system, since I really like making my car look like an epileptic seizure, it can be frustrating to force your car towards those 10 stars when you just want to keep your car looking as clean as possible. This is the only Need for Speed game where a visual rating system like this was ever implemented, which does make this game yet a bit more unique, but hearing what basically every other person in the world has to say about it, it's no surprise that no other game ever got it again. In short, sprint and circuit races teach you the basics of the game, drift teaches you absolutely nothing, outrun events teach you that the game is broken, and drag teaches you to become a horrible human being. Not a very good prospect for a game which at this point has only reached like, what, 20% completion? But I guess we just have to keep going, and boy does this game keep going. When all is said and done, these events are pretty much all just fine. When you check them off one after another, upgrade your car in between, and progress towards those eventual end credits, there's always some frustration to be expected, but in Underground 2, it never became so bad that I wanted to quit the game. The entire first stage of the game is kind of hit or miss, but in the second and third stage, I was genuinely enjoying myself. Unfortunately, there's one incredibly glaring problem with the game we have to talk about. Underground 2 tells small portions of its story through cutscenes, then lets you do a few races, and then you'll most likely upgrade your car, and then the circle starts over again. But then it starts again, and again, and then even more. Where you had to do around 5 races in order to go from stage 1 to stage 2, this will be more than doubled around the end of the game. Let alone that rubber banding becomes more aggressive, races become longer, and the distance you'll have to cross between events more tedious. There's no fun to be had in 4 lap circuit races where every lap takes 8 minutes, as well as that, as I've said before, you better not make any mistake near the end of one of those races. Those URL races that still felt pretty unique at first, well, that uniqueness goes right out of the window after you have to do 3 of them, all consisting of 4 races on tracks that barely have any variety in them. Special events, well, they're not so special anymore if there's like 5 of them on the world map at the same time. I can only imagine that at this point our main protagonist just has all these magazines lying somewhere near his toilet, just in case he's out of toilet paper. This game's biggest flaw isn't the lack of fast travel, the visual rating system, or the easily exploitable events. It's the fact that it just keeps going long after tedium has already set in. I'm not really talking about the game's story anymore either, and that's basically because the game itself does the same. You only get a few cutscenes of Caleb being angry with everybody, then you'll race him in one of the most underwhelming final races of any racing game, driving 5 laps on the most boring track the game has to offer, and after beating him every single time with more than 20 seconds to spare, the game ends with an SMS saying you've unlocked everything, but only in the quick race menu. What does that mean? Well, that means that the wide body kit, for instance, the most over-the-top piece of customization the game has to offer, is now only unlocked for cars you can use in quick races, not in the career. Do you want it in the career as well? Then you'll have to beat 11 opponents in outrun events, which is not mentioned anywhere, and so for years I just thought the game would never give it to me. But even when all of these frustrations are out of the way and you realize that the game basically builds up to nothing story-wise, that is probably still not scratching the surface of why people tend to dislike Underground 2 over other games in the black box era. That honor goes to something I keep encountering in the games I review. It's not about what is in the game, it's about what isn't. Remember what I said about the first Underground game at the start of this video? About how despite it being a radically new direction for the franchise, many fans still missed one of the definitive features of games like Hot Pursuit? That's right, Underground 2 made the same mistake as its predecessor in that it does not include any police chases. In many ways, its successor, 2005's Most Wanted, is a flawed game as well, with many of the same mistakes that have been made by Underground 2 and Underground before that. But many people tend to forgive it and praise it as the best game in the franchise for the simple fact that those police chases are so incredibly entertaining, which is exactly why people don't do the same for Underground 2. There's a very logical reason why people look back at the black box era of Need for Speed games with a lot of positivity. Every single game they made for this franchise has something to make it either unique, entertaining, or both. Underground 2 is no exception, and it's still my personal favorite. Even when returning to the game for this review, I realized why I love it so much in the first place. From the moment you enter Bayview, with its shining lights and varied city streets, you can already feel that it has something special about it. Whether you look at the city itself, or simply because of the fact that it has become such an obvious period piece. In no other game of this time is the customization aspect of this subculture portrayed as authentic, or in some cases as over the top. Despite its flawed visual rating system, the extent in which you can customize several aspects of the cars is commendable, and it is still one of the main reasons why people remember Underground 2. Though I admit that most of my love for this game comes from an excessive amount of nostalgia that makes me less irritated about aspects that other people don't enjoy. Especially because the 20 years after Underground 2's release were also filled with many games that improved upon what was presented here, despite the racing genre as a whole not really being in a good place right now. I admit that races aren't that interesting overall, customization might not be everyone's favorite, the amount of cars you can choose from isn't impressive by any means, the story, well, there basically isn't even a story to begin with, no fast travel, no police chases, and many games have surpassed it graphically, visually, and or gameplay wise. But on the other hand, it was the first game to try an open world and free roaming, many of the cars that are in the game are fan favorites, there is a decent amount of variety in races, and stylistically the game still looks great, while also being a nice little piece of janky 2000s nostalgia. In the end, however, I was becoming a bit more disappointed. After playing it again for this review, I can definitely admit that the game overstays its welcome by just dragging on and on. That length is not justified by its earlier mentioned story, which can be summarized in the span of 2 minutes. And so the gameplay comes across as being artificially lengthened for the sake of runtime. Breaking that gameplay loop by free roaming through Bayview unfortunately isn't enjoyable enough to justify that runtime either. And back in 2004, people still had to wait another year for something as revolutionary as Most Wanted's open world police madness. Nowadays, of course, that is no longer a problem. All of these games have been released decades ago, so just buy them right now and enjoy all of it. Wait, you can still play them, right? I would have recommended everyone to play Underground 2 despite its flaws, just like I would with Most Wanted, Porsche Unleashed or Pro Street. But unfortunately, their biggest flaws are not the games themselves, but their publisher. EA being EA, they either never released a digital copy of the older NFS games, or, in the case of the relatively newer titles, they've been blacklisted from digital storefronts since 2021. So has this review or any other review you've seen convinced you to play Underground 2? Then grab yourselves an eye patch and a parrot and sail the seven cyber seas in search for a cracked version, or pray to the heavens above that some dingy guy on the internet wants to sell you his physical copy. This incredibly unfortunate form of artificial scarcity not only means that people will try to get their hands on these classic titles in less than legal ways, but it might also just mean that some people might never be able to experience or relive the golden age of Need for Speed games. And even though it kinda sucks to end this 40 plus minute love letter to one of my favorite racing games on such a sour note, this is the depressing reality that these older Need for Speed titles find themselves in. Thanks for watching. As always, I hope you liked this video. If you did, consider liking it and subscribing to my channel. A special thanks to the people of NFS Extra Options. I used the free roam camera in their Extra Options mod for some of the shots in this video. I put a link to this awesome mod in the description below, so check it out if you're interested in stuff like that. And of course, thank you for all of the support so far. And I hope to see you in the next video. Bye!